Oh yeah.
Time to step off all of the pedals. Hello everyone, Danny Gill here, and so nice of you to join me this evening. Welcome to my humble abode. So what are we gonna talk about tonight? Well, in the next 30 minutes or so, we're gonna talk about how to make the most of your practice time. I get a lot of questions about this. So, of course, what you work on is dependent upon what your interests are. It's not always going to be the same. You know, when you go to work out at the gym, you don't want to always do the same workout. You got to mix it up a little bit. But there are four general areas that are good to focus on. There are warm-ups, improvisation, technique, and learning songs. So we'll talk a little bit about each of those areas. So let's start with warm-ups. Got my delay on. I'll take that off. So perhaps not the most exciting of all those subjects. It's not going to be full shred, but the idea with warming up is it's really beneficial to get the most out of your practice time because warming up well allows you to execute all these ideas that you have. If your fingers are not flexed out and moving as they should, it's going to be hard for you to jump into the new Nuno solo, for example. So warming up is something that I've always, always done. And my practice sessions don't feel right or as comfortable, or I don't have the stamina if I don't warm up. And it doesn't have to be an intense warm up. 5 minutes, 10 minutes is great if you have 10 minutes, if you're doing a longer session. So what are some of the things we can warm up with? Well, let's start off with just, you know, something simple, kind of nonsensical, just to get the fingers feeling the fretboard. So here's one that I like to do. Focus in on my guitar here. Call it the spider crawl. So I just have each finger on a separate fret. I'm taking the middle four strings here. So I've got the A string on the first fret, second fret D, third fret G, fourth fret on the B. Beautiful chord there. And I'm simply just gonna move up one fret and reverse it like a mirror image. So now instead of one, two, three, four, frets one, two, three, four, I shift it around and I have two, three, four, five. Ah, beautiful, beautiful. So if you're holding your guitar, take 10 seconds and try that out. How do your fingers feel around the fretboard? Does it feel like they're doing something new that they haven't quite done before? Hopefully it should feel a little different. That's the whole idea. You want to get your fingers to do something that they're not used to doing so you don't always play the same things. So that's one. I call it the spider crawl. You can try different string sets as well. You can stay in one position. That's all good. Here's another one. I'll go back and say, hey, just so you know, I'm still here and not just guitar. So here's one. If we have fingers 1, 2, 3, and 4, we can just do a little sequence. So I'll take the first fret and just go 1, 2, 3, 4, and come back down 4, 3, 2, 1. We're halfway there. Then I'll go 1, 4, 3, 4, 2, 4, 3, 4. So you can look at it like four pieces of four notes each. If you've never done it before, it may take you a little time to wrap your head and fingers around it. The whole idea is your fingers are doing what your brain is telling them to do. They're not just wandering off on their own. So try and be disciplined about this stuff. And it's not a race. You don't want to do it fast. The whole idea is to warm up so that you can do the faster, more complex stuff later. So here it is, close up. And I wouldn't do it any faster than that, but then maybe you move up a fret and do it. And I'm alternate picking. Go through one more. This one is called a diminished chord relay, something I learned from Joe Satriani so many, many, many years ago, and I still do it to this day. And oddly enough, I listen to Howard Stern all the time. I love the Howard Stern show. And Metallica was recently on there, and Kirk was noodling in the background. And so Howard's saying, what are you doing over there? And he's like, I'm warming up. And he goes, oh, well, what do you do to warm up? You know, he's very interested in everything. And he said, well, I'm doing this diminished chord relay, or I'm not sure exactly what he called it, but it's the same thing. And he goes, and I learned this from Joe Satriani so many years ago. So it's something that seems to have stuck with all of Joe's students. So it is this. It's a diminished chord, and it's in each of the four inversions. So there's G could be the root note. I have G, C sharp could be the root note. E could be the root note. A sharp could be the root note. So each of these shapes will be the same four notes, just in a different order, in inversions. And since there's four notes, each a minor third apart, we're gonna do four pieces. So there's the first piece, that's a diminished seven chord. And here's the next one. Here's the next one. And then we're gonna come up here and back down. So that was. And then I'm simply gonna move it up one fret and keep going. Tons of fun. So you can do that maybe seven frets worth. But altogether, this will not even take 5 minutes, and maybe your fingers feel a little more warmed up. I also like to do just really slow vibrato exercise just to, you know, feel how the fretboard is for the day. Maybe I've played a lot the day before and my fingers are like extra stiff, so I need to really warm up slowly. Or maybe they're cold, or maybe I just have nervous energy and I want to get control of the guitar. So doing a slow vibrato, just trying to do it in tempo with each finger. Nice and even. I like to do that, maybe stay in 12th position and do that on all six strings. So, you can also find all of this stuff on the Lick Library site. So I'm gonna share my screen here and just show you where you can find some of this stuff. So. Bear with me while we do the tech here. All the technology. So I am on here. I'm going to share my screen. And let's see. I am sharing my screen. So here is an old video of mine. Look at that young pup. And I just talked through this. This is from Guitar Aerobics. So you can find this stuff on the site. There's three guitar aerobics lessons or packages, and this is from the third one. The next exercise, this will be a diminished chord exercise. What I'm going to do is play a diminished chord on the bottom four strings, starting on G with my middle finger. So I have these notes, G, C sharp, E, A sharp. Now I'm going to play four shapes that will give me the exact same four notes. Here's the next shape. So now I'm playing E, A sharp, C sharp, and G. So if I put those two together. Okay, so you get the idea. Of course, there's also the looper here. So maybe I want to start the loop here. I can hit it once and it goes to my starting position, A. Here's the first chord shape. Second chord shape,
and I just want to loop
here's
that.
Here's the first chord shape, second chord shape. Here's the first chord shape, second chord shape. Awesome, so that's it. Don't be shy, use the looper, go back, find Guitar Aerobics. There's lots of warm-ups. So I will stop the share, and here we are, back live. And you guys, feel free to write me any comments, questions. It'd be fun to hear from you. Let me know if you're out there. So warm-ups, very important. I love to get a good warm-up in. My sessions always go better, and I'm able to play for a longer period of time throughout the day without burning out. That's a really important thing for me. Okay, improvisation was another area. So what is improvisation? You've probably heard that term a million times, but improvisation is mixing up your ideas and putting things in a new order on the spot. It's very rarely actually playing something that you've never played before, but the order of things that you've played before comes through in the context of a song. So that's what improvisation is. So you need to have a lot of ideas to successfully improvise. It's not just, I'm just gonna close my eyes and just feel it, man. It's sometimes you get lucky like that, but a lot of times you have to have things worked out. So think about what are some of the ideas you can do. I'd be very interested for you guys to take a pen, pencil, piece of paper, write on your phone, however you like to write stuff down. What are some of the ideas you can use when improvising? So I'm gonna play some Jeopardy style music, and you're gonna think about some of the ideas that you would use when improvising. Write down five things. You should be able to get five ideas. Okay, so let's see how you did. For me, you know what? This would be really good. I'm gonna go to see if anybody, is anybody chatting with me? Oh my God, a broken wrist. No. Woo. There was, how long do you spend on warm-ups? If I can get 10 minutes in, I'm super happy. If I do 20 minutes, then I am like crazy happy. But that rarely happens anymore. 10 minutes is great. Have you not aged? Why, thank you very much. Okay, hit us up. Improvisation ideas. Dynamics, great. Excellent. So some things, here's what I was thinking. It might have been kind of a tough question, not knowing where my mind is at. But I would say sequences are part of improvisation, but it's a practice technique. You have to practice your sequences. You've probably heard... something like that. It's a pentatonic scale, right? It's a sequenced pentatonic scale, group of three. That's something I've practiced, but I can use it when I improvise. E minor, group of four. Sequences. Hammer-ons and pull-offs. String skipping ideas. You know, two-hand tapping stuff. I wrote a few down just to, you know, refresh my memory here. Two-hand tapping, dynamics. I wrote that one down. Use different pickup combinations. You know, you get a different sound when you pick towards the bridge than when you pick towards the neck. Especially if you have a lot of overdrive. Take off some of that overdrive for now. Okay, so yeah. Wasn't a lot. So two-hand tapping, harmonics, string skipping, arpeggios, dynamics, use different pickups, picking different parts of the guitar, outside licks. So maybe you, for example, what does that mean outside? Well, playing a scale that maybe you wouldn't think of. If you have a song that's A minor, you don't have to just stick with the notes of A minor, and this is a whole another world. But just for example, if I take a pentatonic lick, and I just go maybe a half step below each of the times I hit the fifth fret. So just playing a little stuff that's maybe a little outside of like your standard minor scale or minor pentatonic scale. Repetitive licks, you know, you have to have a whole bunch of these whittlies, you know, the... So you have to have a bunch of those kinds of just blues repetitive licks. Everybody's got licks that they like to pull out of their bag when they're improvising. Intervals, you know, doing things where instead of just doing the notes right next to each other, intervals would be. For example, or, you know, I take. Did a pentatonic scale. Some of this stuff I know may be talking a little fast, but you know, I'm doing intervallic ideas. So instead of just going with a pentatonic scale, maybe I go these are fifths. So there's tons of ideas. My point of all this is write these ideas down. As you have a backing track, try and apply some of these ideas as you're improvising so you're not just kind of saying, okay, I'm going to work on my improvising and not have an idea of what you're doing. So I think it's really helpful just to have a list. Okay, I'm going to try and do some intervallic stuff instead of just having all the notes be super close for this round of soloing. And the next round of soloing, I'll try and do some hammer-ons. So that's kind of a long explanation. But on the Lick Library site, there are a lot of backing tracks, and backing tracks allow you to put your ideas in context. You don't want to practice with a backing track 100% of the time. You know, when you're working out a group of four, for example, you got to spend the time working that out before it's going to sound natural in your improvisation. But when you actually want to play music and try these ideas out in a musical context, it's a great idea to take a backing track. So let me show you how you can find a cool backing track on the site. So I'll go back to my screen share. There are tons of backing tracks on the site, right? So if I go to backing tracks, jam tracks, all jam tracks, let's say I want to find one. Let's say I want to do fast tempo, and I've gone to guitar jam tracks as opposed to song backing tracks. Guitar jam tracks, fast tempo. I want to do it in E minor, so I can put E minor in there. And let's see what comes up. One that comes up is the one that I was jamming on. This is the E minor Guns N' Roses style rock guitar jam track. So you can just put that on and press play. So if I, let's see, I'll stop the screen share for now, but you get the idea with that. Okay, am I out of the screen share? I think I am. Okay, and Stu's writing to people. This is great. Is just doing scales up and down pointless noodling? No, absolutely not pointless, because you've got to get a base for what to do. But I find I've certainly spend my time doing scales up and down, but the problem is you don't want to use that when playing music. You rarely hear a solo where it's just a scale up and down as an exercise. One thing I found helpful is to take a scale. I'll stick with A minor for now. But instead of just doing it in one position up and down, I'll take each string, one string at a time. So I have A, B, C, D, E, F, G. And then maybe do some sequences based around there. So one that's common is every other note. They call this diatonic thirds. Diatonic just means within the seven note scale. So if I take every other note, instead of going straight up, I'll go. And if you do that kind of thing with every string, it's a really good way to connect the neck, and also you engage your ears a little more. When you just do the scales up and down, it tends to just be a finger exercise as opposed to really thinking of the melody and the intervals, the distance between the notes. So maybe I'll put on that backing track once again. This is that slash style jam track. And I'll talk loudly over it as I play. So maybe I'll I'll start off with some unison bends. And I'll I'll try and shout some ideas over the top. We'll see how this goes. Okay, now how about just some licks, blues licks? Hammer-ons and pull-offs. Two-handed stuff. Fun with toys. Okay, so that was warm-ups and improvisation. So that's a lot of stuff. Technique, that's another thing we're gonna talk about. You gotta work on your technique. So there's so many different techniques. I mean, take 10 seconds and write down some guitar playing techniques that you think would be good to work on, or just some that you've heard of. Let's go to the chat. Do I play every day? I absolutely play every day. There are some days, you know, you're out with the family on the weekend or doing something. Sometimes the hand just needs to rest. But otherwise, yeah, I play every day. I love the feeling of playing so much that things start to flow. I find that sometimes I can go without playing and I can pick up a guitar and it feels really good and fresh and have some ideas. Sometimes it's like I have to play a long time and then the ideas start to flow. And I love the feeling of having played so much that it's like, okay, I've exhausted all of the stuff that is my standard stuff. So now I've become a little more free. All right, let's see. Bends with vibrato. Yes, absolutely. Super important technique. So, sweeping, yes. Open strings, these are great. Arpeggios, please, show us how you make music with arpeggios. Pinched harmonics, yes, these are awesome. Hybrid picking. I do hybrid picking a lot. So all of these are just perfect examples. Hybrid picking, we're not going to go into all of these techniques today. There's a lot of things available on the site. I'll take a look at some of them with you as well. But, you know, if you have a lick like, and you do hybrid picking, it can make it a little easier. Grabbing that third note with my middle finger. I don't know if you can see that or not. Like you said, arpeggios or sweep picking, sometimes they go together. like I did this. E minor. So there's lots of examples of this. Let me show you another one on the Licklibrary site where you can take a look at techniques. There's string skipping packages that I've done. There's sweep picking. There's just everything is available. But I'll tell you what, let's see. These are some good comments. I like it. I'm going to try and just do some of these techniques over a backing track. Let's see if we can apply some of these. So I'm going to go to a different backing track now. This is going to be one you might recognize. Little Beatles backing track. So for this one, I'm going to take the idea of arpeggios. What's an arpeggio? An arpeggio is when you play the notes of a chord one at a time, so it sounds like a scale. So if you have a D major chord, you play all the notes together, you've got the chord. If you play one note at a time, you've got the arpeggio. So this is like a Beatles backing track. It's that While My Guitar Gently Weeps. And you know, if you have this, this part where it goes, I'm just gonna play a little bit, and when it gets to that D to E, I'm gonna try and find some of the notes of those chords, because that's the part that really stands out to me as being a little bit different. So, and if I play A minor the whole time, I miss some of those notes. The D chord has D, F sharp, A. So if I find that F sharp when the D chord comes around, that's gonna be powerful. And what does the E chord have? The E chord has E, G sharp, B. So if I find that G sharp, the B note is in the minor scale, but it's not in the minor pentatonic. So those two notes might sound really nice. I'm gonna try and find some of those ideas as opposed to just staying in the minor pentatonic the whole time. It's improvisation, so we'll see what happens. You never know. Okay, So I was trying to find some of those chord tones or arpeggio notes when those two chords came around. I also did some sequences. And I played something in a different order than what I played before. I was improvising in the sense that I was just making that up on the spot, but I went to a lot of things and just kind of mixed it up, you know, just like when you're cooking. Not following the exact same recipe every time, but I got the same ingredients. And I try and add on to it every time. Okay, so that was a little bit with some technique. Another thing, well, the final thing for tonight, talk about learning songs. So why is it important to learn songs? Well, now I'm back. Why is it important to learn songs? Because that's music. That's what you're going to play in front of people. That's what you're going to play when you get into a band situation, no matter what level you're at. If you play in front of somebody, they're going to say, well, play something. And you're probably not going to want to say, well, I know an E minor arpeggio. They're going to want to hear some music. They're going to want to hear, you know, something probably a little more musical. So that's songs put it all together. You have to have a sense of rhythm when you're playing a song, and you've got to have context to all of the single note stuff that you're doing when it comes time to solo or improvise. So also, it's a good idea just to develop your repertoire of songs and add on to it so you have a lot of songs that you can play through regardless of the style. Sometimes it's very good to challenge yourself and pick a song that is difficult, that will take a long time, so you can really see the results after working on a song for 6 months. If it takes 6 months, that's okay. But in the meantime, I think there's no shame in learning simple songs, because you don't want to just get stuck in the vortex of just one thing the whole time. So simple songs can be super rewarding. I mean, I love to play whatever it is. It could be something that's just totally like, you know. Whatever, just making stuff up. But something just high energy, aggressive, Green Day-like. But maybe sometimes I want to sit down and I want to work on a more difficult song, you know. It's one of those Matteo Sassato versions of a Beatles song or something like that. But let me just show you a little bit of how you can learn a song from the Lick Library site. And this will be the final thing that we talk about for today. So I will go back to my screen share. And let's see, we're here, we want to learn. Let's say we want to learn this song. This is a Peter Frampton song, acoustic. So I should have a clean sound. All right, so now we're gonna take a look at the classic track, Baby, I Love Your Way. Great acoustic tune, it's in standard tuning, and the intro goes like this. Okay, so maybe I don't wanna hear myself talk. I could just loop this section. Setting the looper here. Okay, and I'm gonna pause here. So I've got this looper set, and so it's just gonna repeat, but we can also do this, hit that cogwheel. There's a clock up here. What if I wanna slow it down a little bit? Let's see how that works. Yeah. That's it. So I just wanted to show you that. There's tons of songs. I think it's great to learn songs that you can, that don't necessarily take a few months to learn, in addition to those really complex pieces. So try and have a repertoire of songs. Try to learn a new song every week. That's an amazing challenge to give yourself. Of course, everybody's different. Everybody has their lives and different things going on, so you may not reach that goal, but I think it is a really good goal to have. Play with people as much as possible. It doesn't have to be a full band live situation, but you get together with another guitar player or a bass player, and suddenly all this stuff that you get under the hood and look at and practice scales and everything, it all starts to make sense when you get in a room with other musicians. So I can't recommend that enough. But yeah, I guess that's it for our little hang this evening. So thanks for coming in and hanging out with me. And I hope to see you guys all again soon. So I really appreciate it. And so I'm gonna be signing off for now. Thank you so much for watching. See you next time.